Huang, thank you so much. I'm Max Anderson. I'm the Eugene McDermott Director of the Dallas Museum of Art and also co-chair of the Global Cultural Districts Network. And Huang is now joining our panel, which has some remarkable arts leaders who are gracing the stage. And what I'll say next organizationally is that we're going to have a hard stop at 5:45, so worry not. We'll get you to cocktails, whatever you're going to be doing after this. So don't be afraid. We'll be done. But there will probably be very few questions afterwards, since we have a lot to talk about here, and we'll make sure it's as engaging as possible. In your program, you know who's here, but since Mathieu wasn't allowed to come up and say it, I'll just quickly say we have Catherine Cuellar, who's Chief Executive Officer of the Dallas Arts District, and Michael Eissenhauer, who's Director General of the National Museums of Berlin, and we have Huang Gri and his translator, and we have Rip Rapson, who is the President and CEO of the Kresge Foundation. So we're in the Dallas Arts District in no small part because the New Cities Summit asked a question of this gathering about ways in which cities are emerging today in the use of culture, in altering perception of cities, in the use of culture as pillars in urban transformation, and how the experience of culture has changed for the city. So I'm going to start, Rip, with you, which is a question about this explosion of cultural investment that we've seen in the last generation, which has been concentrated very often, yielding brand new arts districts with dramatic architecture, like the one in which we sit as a building, and a bold vision of community involvement. The Kresge Foundation is an investor so often in infrastructure, cultural and otherwise. Help us understand how you as a funder evaluate what's worth investing in and what's perhaps not.
That's an interesting question in that it finds our organization in something of a transition. I mean, for the better part of 75 years, the Kresge Foundation probably would have funded every institution in this district. It was focused on capital improvements and in building projects. And I think the kind of synergy that has gone on in a place like Dallas, I mean, is a validation of that kind of investment. It's an extraordinary thing to see the kind of adjacencies and power of good design and all of the other things that go along with it. The irony, to some extent, is that Kresge has moved away from that model to try to understand whether there aren't other parts of the cultural ecology that deserve investment. It's not that we won't invest in buildings or in infrastructure, but I think we are increasingly trying to understand what other components of sort of cultural activity in a city can help drive a city's, not just a city's economic revitalization, but also its sense of cultural identity, its sense of history, and its sense of citizen engagement. And so we, in some ways, Max, have sort of tried to build out, help build out the rest of the artistic ecology in saying that in addition to these really powerful drivers, Dallas, Minneapolis, Seattle, other places, there is also a way of bringing arts and culture into the center of a whole series of conversations about civic renewal and how low-income people and other people who may not necessarily be part of an arts and cultural district can participate more fully in the sort of the retooling of a city's trajectory. Mm-hmm.
Michael, by contrast, you have an inheritance in Berlin of one of the world's greatest concentrations that has come through the generations to you as leader. Can you give us a little sketch of what the Museum Island is about and the components?
Yes, Max, I tried to. First of all, the National Museums comprise of 15 different museum collections located in 19 different buildings all over Berlin. And you can call the Berlin Museums a kind of universal museum spanning from prehistory to contemporary art. And the diverse buildings are concentrated, you can say, more or less in two hotspots. One is the Museum Island, with five buildings founded in the beginning of the 19th century, with in total eight collections, and a second hotspot, which we call Kulturforum, which means cultural forum, nothing else. This is founded in the 1960s, during the division of the city, when the wall stood. And this both hotspots, you can call cultural districts for our museums. And one, the Museum Island, is a UNESCO World Heritage Site, and mostly with the archaeological collections. And the Kulturforum is more or less the European art from the late Middle Ages up to nowadays. And in addition to that, we have some other buildings spread all over Berlin. And for example, the non-European collections with the ethnological collections and the Asian art collections and so on, which are still situated in the suburbs of Berlin, will move in the next years to, maybe you've heard about this, to the new built city palace, which we call the Humboldt Forum, which is very close to the Museum Island. So on the long end, on the long run of this development, more or less, the museums are mostly concentrated in the core of the Berlin city.
And that's really what the Global Cultural Districts Network is contrived to figure out, how we can work together across the world with these concentrated spaces and think about economies of scale, professional development, training, programmatic alliances, travel and trade, marketing, tourism. So we're looking forward to that conversation, which Adrian Ellis is the Executive Director will be helping us with in the next sessions tomorrow and the next day. And I would just point out, if you want to hashtag GCDN, that's where we're following the Global Cultural Districts Network conversation. Huang, you have just given us some insight into Beijing and its vital art spaces that you're responsible for. So you're an artist, you're an activist, and you're also a community builder. And I'd like your opinion on some of the larger investments that cultural planners have who are dreaming of cultural tourism. How do we make sure they don't leave out the community and focus only on tourism? You can relax, Huang. You're on autopilot. You just speak and we'll hear you.
是这样，因为这个中国有两个情况，我先解释一下，它一个是表面现象，一个是实在发生的。这个在两个环境里同时存在两个现象，在一个还是有两个环境存在，一个是真正的艺术运动，在一个呢是政府的活动，在体制里边的组织化和制度化和制度化的艺术环境。
China's situation is a little bit unique. Let me explain it a little bit for you first. There are two situations in China. One is more of an artificial exhibition of arts development, which is organized mainly by the government. But there are also the real development of arts is in the arts community, and those are the real spirits of the art development.
包括在两个环境在一起的时候，它都有两个现象，一种是一个在这个整个投资环境的假象和城市发展需要文化这部分引入的一个假象，但是实质上它有这个左手和右手不同力量的制约。
And the two phenomena actually coexist as almost like working simultaneously. You can see a lot of investment that either by the government or by some organization that invested heavily in different big cities. And also you can see some vibrant development among the arts community, which is working independently of the investment.
Thank you. You know, I'm going to ask Catherine, since we're in your arts district, all of us today, and as the CEO of the Dallas Arts District, you oversee this esplanade of buildings and activities. Give us some sense of what people are sitting in the middle of, since much of the day has been spent in this beautiful facility.
Sure. Well, you know, Dallas's arts district is the largest contiguous urban cultural neighborhood in the United States. So we have 20 square blocks of performance halls, and art galleries and parks, restaurants. We're hoping to add more residential capacity in the coming year. We were kind of coming to the end of a 30-year cycle of vision, planning, and generosity that has connected all of these dots, and now we're starting to work on the infill. But we also are able to export talent from Dallas to the wider world. So across the street at the Wiley Theater, Dallas Theater Center was recognized earlier this year by First Lady Michelle Obama as having the best after-school program in the United States in their Project Discovery program. They spend $500,000 US dollars a season giving season tickets to high school students who get pre-show education. They are bused from their schools to the shows. And like every student, every ticket holder at a Dallas Theater Center performance, after the show, they get to talk to a member of the cast. The Dallas Opera here had a global simulcast of Death and the Powers in partnership with MIT, in which there was an app developed by students who had worked on the video game Guitar Hero. And I got to be part of the global audience at the Royal Academy of Music in London, where everyone from Andrew Lloyd Webber to Elton John has studied, as we were able to control the backdrop and the chandelier here in the opera using the smartphone and tablet app and toggle between the front of house camera and the view of the house from robots that were on stage being navigated by Xbox controllers. Jaap van Zweden, the maestro of the Dallas Symphony Orchestra, made his debut at Concertgebouw as a teenager, and he's also a guest conductor at the Philharmonic Orchestra of Hong Kong, which is part of the West Kowloon Cultural District, part of our Global Cultural Districts Network. And we have the new curator from the Tate Modern, Gavin De La Hunte, who's joining us. So we are both a training ground for artists like the five seniors who just graduated from Booker T. Washington High School for the Performing and Visual Arts across the street going to Juilliard in the fall, and distinguished alumni of that school, including Nora Jones and Erica Badu and Edie Brickell. But we're also a place where artists want to come, and through Theater Communications Group and the Association of American Choral Directors and the International Association of Blacks in Dance, Dallas is becoming a destination city for creative professionals because of the excellent quality of life that artists enjoy here, and because our community has demonstrated its commitment to generously supporting the artists and the venues.
So it's really a third model, because we know from Michael there's a government-supported, public-supported cultural offer. From Huang, there's a kind of auto-generated, street-built, remarkable efflorescence, and you're talking about philanthropy as well as public support. So Rip, you have always challenges in thinking about stimulating the return of investment as well in places that may be in some ways disinvested. What are the ways in which arts and culture can stimulate the private markets to come into these spaces that might benefit from these types of investments?
Our foundation is based in Detroit. And there's probably no better example of, it seems to me, the power of sort of multidimensional artistic expression, essentially clearing the way for the kind of investment you've talked about. You know, 5 or 6 years ago, when I first came to Detroit, there was sort of episodic cultural energy. I mean, there's always been in Detroit, obviously, and an enormous amount of creative expression, and you know, in the presenting arts and music, theater, and everything else. But what I think has happened over the last 5 or 6 years is that the arts and cultural community, as it has in so many places in America, has sort of taken the front line of risk. It has moved into physical places that others won't go. It has reused existing infrastructure in ways that others won't do, and it has done it on a shoestring. And as a result, not only do you get small business formation, artists as small business actors, but you get a sort of a resettlement of a place in a way that is sort of infused with vibrancy and street life and sort of cultural exploration. And so I think in many ways what's happened in Detroit is that the artistic and cultural communities have been sort of the first line of pioneers that sort of demonstrate that investment is safe in a place that has traditionally been disinvested. And you're beginning to see nodes of energy around not just young people, but people also who have chosen to come back to Detroit and participate in that kind of environment. It's been a really powerful thing. And I think in the wake of artists have come small business owners, have come techies, hipsters, Detroiters who've wanted a reason to come back to Detroit. I mean, it's been a very powerful sort of front line of creating the way for that kind of investment to return.
Michael, you've heard about safe places to invest, and I'm curious, for the Americans in the audience for whom massive government support of the arts is a foreign concept, literally, would you help us understand how politics change the dynamics of funding of culture in Europe? And when ministries change, when electoral politics change, how does that affect your freedom to maneuver as an administrator and an executive?
A fundamental for this question, quite sure, is the different system of funding. Not only museums, but culture as a part of public life. And from our understanding, from the traditional understanding of German funding art and cultural tasks, this is an understanding which bases even in the constitutional rights. So from a certain point, you even can call it a constitutional obligation to fund cultural life in Germany. And this mostly comes from the municipalities and the federal, respective federal states, and from only a very rare institutions, which we are as well, from the nation itself, from the national government. So the impact on changing parties in the government is not so intensive as it could be seen from outside. So there is a large commitment in the whole society that cultural obligations should be part of public life. And but the other side of the medal is quite sure that also for us, the budgets are going down, or they don't increase compared to inflation. So we as well have to look how to raise money. And one of our main incomes is what you don't know, mostly don't know, that we earn entrance fee. So it's not very low, but it's accepted, well accepted, that cultural should cost something, even for individuals. And as the same as you go to theaters or to go to symphony orchestra or to the Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra, you have to pay for the ticket. And this is the same for us. And the largest part of our incomes really comes from the entrance fee. And this is very important for us. And on the last aspect, perhaps one should think that if we really sell service to people to teach them about cultural heritage or legacy, and so we don't work in an ivory tower, and from seeing it from a very certain, special point, I'm not so offended by taking money from the people, because it gives us a kind of energy to think how we could get better to stick the people to us.
Huang, let me ask you, because you started 798 as a dream, as a vision. At the same time, across China, hundreds of cultural facilities are being built by central government and by regional government. What advice would you give to some of the people who are responsible for those new projects who may not have the same founding vision that you had in Beijing?
On the one hand, I don't really want to have them go through what I have been through before, because before it's totally building from nothing.
但是另一方面，我们从第三个角度，我也看到他们的一些问题，比如说我对798，它的现状和它的未来，就有过一些，就是在隔一段时间会给它一些建议。But
on the other hand, because I see the problem and the difficulties we face through the development of 798. So I really like to give them some advice on what the things that they could encounter, what difficulties they would encounter during the process.
比如从这个方面，我做这个回答，我会这样来说：，以七九八这样的情况，去年他们的游客超过了360万，所以他在这个他的旅游，他在这个城市环境里，他建立自己的形象，他的身份和他获得的经济成功，他已经证明。
As a matter of fact, 798 last year has seen the tourists visited the area. More than 3.6 visitors visited that area. So in itself is actually a success, and people can see that it's a success. So in a way that they don't need my advice in terms of telling them what to do.
以前我们曾经计算过，我们曾经帮助他去看到过去和现在存在的艺术可能性，但是现在他没有一个对将来的展望。比如这些问题会出来，一个是作为一个商业艺术中心的平台，它能保持多少的自由度？现在这样，实际上它这个自由度是越来越收缩的。 再一个呢，它的艺术质量和艺术实验是不断的缩小。再一个是艺术家在离开798和离798的整体的这个周边的环境，因为它的这个费用的问题产生的这个，因为旅游现象产生的这费用提高的一些问题，都是存在的。
A lot of the calculation that hasn't been done, for example, in the successful story of 798. You can see that because of the increase of tourism, the revenue that brings, that also increases the possibility of increasing fee for artists to be in that area. And also the flexibility or the freedom that the artists could have will be strictly greatly limited because of its success. So the government and probably other organizations will stick their hands into it. So those are the problems that we haven't really faced in the future.
Well, those will be perennial problems, I can assure you. I'd like to ask, because we're really launching the network of cultural districts, if we could go around, since we're circling the globe here from Detroit and Dallas to Beijing to Berlin, if there was a problem you wanted to look at, Rip, with a think tank like this network of cultural districts to research, to look into, what sort of problems might you see it solving? What kinds of questions would you want asked by bringing together the leadership of cultural districts around the world?
I almost think that more than sort of landing on a particular problem set, you might ask them to sort of think about the porosity, the ability of cultural institutions to sort of breathe and to sort of move their work into community and have community work move into them. It's a lot to ask of a major anchoring cultural institution to be all things to all people, but I think increasingly they've become sort of more integral parts of a municipal ecology. And so, you know, they're sort of the mansion on the hill, but you also have the gardens, well-cultivated, sort of mid-sized organizations. You have the greenhouse, people who are sort of getting ready to move up into the other part of the ecology, and then you have the wilds of, you know, the individual artists and people who are doing the kind of pioneering work I suggested. And I think that increasingly we see in the States major anchoring institutions trying to figure out ways to engage the rest of that ecology, because it moves in multiple directions. It's not just audience development, but it's trying to create the street vitality that a community needs. It's trying to make sure that local artists find their way into the more rarefied atmosphere of the large institutions. So my sense is, if there were a challenge that the network could think about, what are the really good models that we could talk about of how that ecology really works at a high functioning level and doesn't become a monoculture? Because I think there is a certain temptation to just have institutions of the absolute highest world excellence sort of sitting in your midst without the kind of connective tissue into the rest of the community that I think really makes a city great.
Catherine, how would you follow up on that for Dallas? What would you be looking for from this network?
Well, I think one opportunity to be seized is the opportunity for us to talk about content being shared among our groups when we're commissioning new works and curating new exhibitions, that they could have their European debut in Berlin and their North American debut here in the Dallas Arts District and their Asian debut at a member cultural district there. I love the analogy of the mansion and the gardens and the greenhouse, because we have those three and the wilds. We have it all in every city.
And now we have to build a garden on the roof.
Yes, exactly. So as we're talking about cities and the future of cities, I really think that talking about how we can help artists at each of those transitions from the wilds to the greenhouse to the garden to the mansion and the support systems that are needed, because I think that there are common challenges that are cross-disciplinary as well.
Michael, earlier we were talking and you said that you felt Berlin was a bit to the east of where some of the energy is in Europe, and yet we think of Berlin as the cultural capital today of Europe. So tell us, what could the network be doing with your help to answer questions about the needs that you have in Berlin?
From some extent, we look quite successful in the Berlin development, but looking from inside, we are not as successful as we could be, or sometimes I would like to be. Because I told you, we've got two districts which you could call cultural districts. One of the Museum Island, which is enormous successful. We have up to 3 to 4 million visitors a year in our museums there. And the second one, which is very, very attractive, just imagine the Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra is beside one of our buildings. It's a famous Mies van der Rohe pavilion of the Neue Nationalgalerie. And we have the National Library there. Masses of people are going in this area, but in our museums, there are only 300,000 to 400,000 visitors a year in this very, very important collections, which might be compared to the National Gallery in London or something else with our old master paintings. And so we are often confronted with the question, why does one cultural district work and the other not? And so I'm as well looking for answers for this. Mm. And I think it's not only depending on collections, it depends on how everything is linked to each other. And especially on the culture from one of our aspects or questions we dropped to ourselves is, might it be depending on how the urban constructed is understood when it was planned. The major thing to compare these both cultural districts in Berlin is that one is very dense and very closely linked to this urban substructure, like restaurants and amenities and greens and public transport systems and so on and so on. And the other one, the Kulturforum, has really nothing of it. The greens are very close to it, but it's very difficult to get there by public transport. The spaces in between these solitaires of famous architectural heritage is vast and wide, windy, and broad traffic streets are going there, and very vast parking lots and so on. But the solitaires are not connected to each other, and it's very difficult to change between these buildings. And so one answer for the question I drop to the group, for example, is how could we raise the Kulturforum to be more successful and to attract more people? Because it cannot depend on the program alone or on what we show. It is much more. It's a question of linking the cultural heritage or the cultural offer we have to what the citizens want to have. Mm-hmm. And so the other point beside urban structure is we are not depending alone on tourists, but as well on the inhabitants of the city where we live. They shall be attracted to get back to us, not only to come once, but spending time there and having the feeling they miss something if they don't come back.
Yeah. Huang, I'm curious what you think China might do to learn from other cultural investments and districts overseas, because so much of what's happening in China is from within, the strength from within, but what could be learned from without?
这是一个很大的问题，其实中国在非常迅速的城市建设发展，这个是属于经济内容的，因为今天早上我们一开始的讨论里边已经介绍中国发展那些很大的超级城市。 这些超级城市呢都属于两届政府制定的中国农村城市化农民转到城市居民化这一个政治政策的一个大运动里面。
This is a big question because we've seen a lot of the rapid economic development in China, especially a lot of the mega city or the massive urbanization in a lot of areas. But these are all economic development. We basically just follow, the government has the policy to actually move a lot of the rural population to the urban area, and that's the result of that.
我曾经被几个城市的美术馆邀请，可是这些活动都展开得非常困难。我们也能知道，这是属于政治政策呢。其实它并不真正的发展文化和艺术，这就是给城市的大多数居民看，这个城市有了一个外形，而且有可能这个城市还有一个漂亮的五官，比如说像歌剧院、美术馆或者是图书馆这样的建筑。
I've been invited to advise in several cities about their art, so-called art district development, but mainly these are all artificial. You have very pretty opera house and very pretty symphony hall. However, these are basically just a structure.
Yeah.
基本上他们在现在做的这些建筑物里边，没有任何投入是为了艺术发展的。这样呢，形成两个状况，是越来越拉开距离。 我觉得现在的这个政策呢，它是推动经济，而使艺术创作的力量感到一种孤独，甚至有一点疏离，有点这个希望破灭的感觉。But
I can say it for sure that these investment has no investment in the actual art or cultural development because they are mainly focusing on the hardware of the investment, and that actually creates a rift between the economic development and actual cultural development in the country.
Let me shift from hardware to software for a minute. Catherine, you're the most wired person I know in the arts district, and partly it's you're a born digital generation, but you're trying to start a radio station. So tell us, how does that fit into the grand scheme of what the Dallas Arts District could be?
Well, I think there's an opportunity with our neighboring high school for there to be kind of a learning laboratory in which our performing arts students can serve as documentarians and archivists who are embedded reporters within each of our stakeholders. I often describe the rich content that our neighborhood has as being like a meteor shower, and it's great if you're on Flora Street to see it, but if you miss it, you're out of luck. So if we could harvest all those stars and turn it into a light show, where we're actually recording it and playing it back on demand and through an app so that there were ways for our audiences to grow beyond just those who are already in the know and connected to one or more of our neighboring institutions. And I think that there's an opportunity to, not only in audience development, but also just in the measurement of our audience. The Dallas Arts District doesn't have a turnstile. It doesn't have a ticket for entry. And so it's difficult for us to deduplicate our subscribers and our patrons to have a sense of, if we have 1 million visitors a year, are those 1 million unique visitors? Or is it 100,000 people coming here 10 times in the course of a year? And can we use some of the interest in certain types of programming, all the programming that's in the commons, so not orchestra musicians who are members of unions and not playwrights whose works are subject to copyright, but all the conversations we're having here that have a large and growing audience interested in extending the conversation in the digital space. It just seems like a natural way to measure our impact and also record what's happening so that it has a life beyond the moment that is shared in the real space time continuum.
Rip, I'm curious within the foundation community if that resonates. That is the media space one of interest broadly in U.S. philanthropy to look at as a vehicle for culture beyond these beautiful buildings we're in?
Sure. I mean, I think probably the best example we have in philanthropy is the Knight Foundation with its specialization in journalism, sort of next generation journalism, and its interest in places. And they've really put those two pieces together in a powerful way. I wanted to just flip the script just slightly. I think it's responsive, Max, and suggest that, you know, one of the things that we haven't talked about when we think about new cities and sort of the next generation of best practice in cities is the ability of the arts to be integral players in sort of the problem smashing. I mean, it is one thing for folks to come to an institution of art and culture. It's another thing for arts and cultural activity to really sort of take on transit, housing, immigration, civic participation. And I think what you're seeing in some of the most forward-looking American cities is exactly that, that artists, rather than sort of standing at the outside the fence line and sort of watching as people sort of problem solve in community development or in health or wherever else they're trying to tackle these problems, they're actually getting into the mix and really mixing it up. And I think as a result, what you get is a higher level of creativity, a higher level of innovation, much more innovative ways of thinking about community engagement, because arts and culture become the wonderful way to sort of engage community voice and community tradition. And so I think one of the huge powers of arts and culture in sort of the next urban order is to be sort of more present, more seen, more impactful. And again, in a place like Detroit, you just can't help it. They simply have got to be in the mix, otherwise I think the community simply won't end up realizing its full potential.
Michael, you touched on ticket selling and the commercial paradigm that's beginning to be a bigger part of European cultural offerings. I'm just curious, in this country, we're often attempting today to make a case for public support. In Detroit, the millage that was passed for the Detroit Institute of Arts, which yielded over $20 million of annual support. Here, Catherine helped with others lead the effort to a public improvement district that's actually tax supporting the arts district to some extent. But in Germany, in Europe, how is economic change, as you said, things have gone flat in government supporting institutions, how is that affecting commercialization? How is that affecting your thoughts about the Museums Institute being more commercial as an environment?
Diverses very much from each respective country, and seeing it from the Berlin side or from the German side, one of our threats, I may call it threat, is that the governments or the public authorities withdraw themselves from supporting cultural and cultural life. And I think this is mostly threatening because from my special side, the governments or the community of nations or every city and all the regions are responsible to protect the heritage not only of art but as well of the heritage of regions and nations and mankind. And so I think the largest threat under economic pressure is that they withdraw step by step, being responsible to protect it. And from especially from the museum side, I think it's very threatening just to consider that our cultural heritage, our cultural legacy is not seen as a public property or public obligation. An obligation for our children and our successors. But the threatening thing is that it may change to a primarily seen aspect of economy and profitability. Mm-hmm. Thank you. And as a consequence, it could be threatening that we only looking at what sells best and not what is best art and what should be the critical aspects of art. And so I think we should be very exactly looking on our programs, not to feel under the economic pressure to modify our programs and to be responsible to not only to show what attracts mm-hmm. as well as what is necessary mm-hmm. in our responsibility in which we stand. And so Let me finalize it just to express that I think living in a cultural society, living with cultural life as an important part of our daily life, means to understand cultural life as a kind of daily food. And we need food to survive. Yeah. And I think all men and all mankind need cultural life for surviving as well, as civilized persons and civilized nations. And so I think the threatening thing is that the public responsibility for supporting cultural life is to withdraw under economic pressure.
Well, you spoke of food, and Huang, I have one last question for the panel, and then we'll see if we have some questions from the audience. And it's a question about artists. We've talked a lot about buildings and districts and capital, but artists are the basis of it all. And if you were to say the top priorities for you in providing seeding for cultural districts, what is it? Is it housing that's subsidized? Is it grants for artists? What is it that you would think is most necessary for a flourishing cultural center?
我建议啊，其实这个在达拉斯他已经开始了一个工程，其实解决艺术家。 增添在这里边城市的有内容的艺术活动，同样是一个重要的工程。这个需要，比如说像 Max 这样的人组织起来，共同考虑。就是像今天，比如介绍达拉斯的发展，有一位女士在这儿介绍达拉斯的发展，然后他们在中间做了公园一样，这是在中心的街道做公园和在中心的区域，请来一些艺术家。 比如说啊，是周边城市的美国人，或者是通过城市的交流，给一种项目和一种标准设定一些资助，然后请来一些国外的艺术家过来在这儿参与和市民在一起的一些活动。我觉得这个是在工程里边各个项目和内容需要有一些提案，有一些技术问题。
I think that Dallas has done a great job. For example, in this arts district that you have done, not only a lot of the put together some of the great buildings, performance halls, but also a park in the middle of it, and also organize a lot of events. For example, the events like this, like credit to Max and also Catherine, that this kind of events draw artists to come over here. And with different projects and with different activities, you will attract a lot more artists to come over and pay attention to what you're doing here. And that will actually create an atmosphere and actually increase the visibility and also have a lot of more opportunities for other artists to do things here. And that's a great start, at least.
That was an unexpected bouquet, and I thank you, Juan. We have among us today the mayor of San Sebastian. And San Sebastian will be the European cultural capital in 2016. And I was hoping we could elicit just a comment about how the preparation for that signal honor is changing the city of San Sebastian. Your Honor, where did you disappear to, if you're here? We may have lost him.
We lost him.
Ah.
What a pity.
We need a microphone. Uh-huh. That's all we need.
Thank you. Lo primero, lamentar que no va a poder hablar en inglés y agradecer esta oportunidad y poder intervenir en esta mesa tan interesante.
First of all, I apologize for not being able to communicate in English, but thank you. I want to thank the panel for this opportunity to speak.
Nosotros nos hemos hecho una reflexión y nos hemos planteado tres retos ante el 2016. La reflexión sería que la cultura no puede ser solo un producto de consumo, algo que alguien produce y más o menos gente consume, o no puede ser solo una serie de grandes infraestructuras.
In preparation for this event, we have been thinking and we have come to three thoughts that we've had. Number one is that culture cannot be just a product of consumerism. And infrastructure.
Y los tres, las tres retos, las tres reflexiones son, en primer lugar, que invertir por la administración pública en cultura en una época de crisis económica no solo es necesario, sino que es muy importante.
And what we've been thinking is that in the middle of this economical crisis that we're facing, for the administration to invest is very important.
En segundo lugar, sería que hay que poner en valor el proceso de creación cultural.
Second, we have to give value to the process of cultural creativity.
El creador piensa en crear algo y hay un proceso con un resultado final. Ese proceso es el que hay que poner en valor también.
The creator starts thinking and then he starts creating and there needs to be a value in that creative process.
Y lo tercero, y quizá lo más importante,
and third, maybe the most important thing.
La cultura es y debe ser una herramienta para construir ciudad y para la convivencia entre diferentes.
And
la cultura es una herramienta.
Culture is a tool
para construir ciudad.
To build city.
Y crear entre diferentes.
And to create among different people, people of different thoughts.
San Sebastián, el País Vasco.
San Sebastián, the Basque country.
Es un país que ha sufrido mucho durante muchos años.
It has suffered a lot for many years.
Hay mucha gente que se ha distanciado mucho.
We've had a lot of people that have walked away from each other.
Estamos seguros de que la cultura va a ayudar a cerrar heridas y a crear juntos entre diferentes.
And we are sure that culture is going to help close wounds and to bring people together.
Your Honor, we look forward to following your progress, and we thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Now, I promised to get us out of here at 5:45, which means hashtag GCDN. If you have questions, we can follow up after the session. We have time for one question, one thoughtful, precise question with a surgical response. Yes. this lady actually got my attention first, yes. If you'll indulge.
Can you all pass it down to her? Thank you.
So I think it's an integrative question, and I'm directing it to Catherine. If I understood correctly, you talked about introducing housing into the arts quarter. So can you tell us whether that was part of an original master plan or whether it's a retrospective stitch in because ideas of adjacency and cross-fertilization and mixed use have changed? And can you tell us what provision you have in mind, even if it's not yet a plan, for a socially inclusive spread of occupants of this housing?
I'm so glad you asked. And it's actually, I'm looking out at the faces of some of the people who have helped to make it happen. So this summer, on the surface parking lot that you'll pass tonight between the Meyerson Symphony Center and the Nasher Sculpture Center, we will break ground on Flora Lofts, which will be a publicly subsidized affordable housing component in a mixed-use development. So that surface parking will go underground, there'll be street-level retail, there'll be three floors of affordable apartment homes for artists and their families, and then the top floor will be market-rate housing, or as I jokingly call it, unaffordable housing that I'll arm wrestle you for. And the nonprofit La Reunion, Texas, will serve as the curator of those units to determine who gets those residences. The Arts District Master Plan dates to the pre-construction early 1980s, and a lot of the aspects of that are now dated, in no small part due to the real estate crash of the mid-1980s. So one of the things we'll be working on in the next 18 to 24 months will be a study and an update reflecting the built environment as contrasted with what the initial master plan envisioned. But certainly the model that La Reunion and Flora Lofts are following is based on Art Space Projects USA, which is an a nonprofit developer of affordable housing for artists in different cities, and they've had different projects from new construction to retrofitting of historic buildings. They actually moved a performing arts center to be close to housing in one place. They've got a center for fire arts, for ceramics and welding and glass, and that's the model that has worked really well, because to your point, in Detroit and elsewhere, when artists decide that they want to live someplace quickly, it can become affordable to them unless there is intention around maintaining affordability for artists. And the artist studio lofts here may be their studios, or it may be that because they're affordably housed, they can afford to have studio space separately from that.
Which is our great dream. And Mathieu will have the last word, but please join me in thanking our panel for this afternoon's presentation. Thank you. All right, allez-y.